So somebody was asking me a question on the break, and it reminded me of a story. And so my son is five, and so I have a five-year-old son, Luke, and my daughter's Evelyn, she's 2.5. And they're very cute. I'll show pictures if you want later. But anyways, they are the most marvelous people on the face of the earth, no offense. But my son Luke, so I try really hard to say to him, you know, not all the time, because of course you hear things all the time, it kind of gets, it becomes just deafening. But I'll say to him, you know, you make this world a better place. I'm so glad to see you today. I'm so happy to see you today. Or, you know, you make my life so much richer. And I said to him a couple weeks ago, I said, you make this world such a good place. And he says, oh, Mom, you always say that. And I was like, yes, he's listening. Like, he hears that. Because when he grows up, I want him to remember that I told him that I feel like he makes the world a better place. And I think, like, again, if that's what I'm known for, fantastic. And so just thinking about that, like, all of the stuff you're doing, it's like layers of paint on a wall. Eventually, you know, you'll get closer to the color you want, but every day, coat your students, layer paint every day, and eventually accumulates, sticks. So if you're a little young probably to get into the show like I am, but I think The Goldbergs is one of the best shows ever created. If you, does anybody watch this show? Oh my God, this show. Okay, so and as a child of the 80s, I grew up during the 80s, so like the fashion and all the references are like right in my wheelhouse. And my husband and I are like, I had that shirt, that was mine. But this kid, Adam, the thing about this show is it's based on the creator, Adam Goldberg. It's based on his life. There's a couple of switches of characters if you go and read like up on the history of him and everything in his family. But this is Adam, and when the show started, he's this little bright, beautiful little man. And in season three, they're entering season four now, but season three is my favorite, and this is from season three. Season three is when he's going through puberty. So the actor is going through puberty, and they've written that into the show, and they've pulled in the real writer, his real experiences as a kid going through puberty. And so I think season three is beautiful, and there's all these references to voice change, all these references to awkward bodies and things like that. And I want to play you this little clip as we transition from talking about like the whole adolescent into voice change. This comes from that, and let's pray that the buffering doesn't create issues here. But this is
back in the day, I was a ridiculously cute kid.
Yes, I am literally the coolest thing alive.
I'm not bragging, it's just pure fact.
My God, you're so cute. I just want to stop.
Oh no!
But of course,
where did it go? Okay, can I fix the volume?
Yeah.
How can I do it?
There's a dial on the podium.
Up here? This?
Ooh.
That's a light. There's a dial.
Where you can use your mic. Your
this?
Mic.
Oh, I'll do my mic.
Okay.
Yeah, good call. That's why you get paid the big bucks. All right, here we go.
Back in the day, I was a ridiculously cute kid.
Yes!
Maybe I could hide the pimples, but the rest was hard to mask.
Let's go! Hustle! This is called scooter ball! Let's hit the corner and talk to Kevin Ball!
I began to smell different.
Whoa! Go far! Wheel it in! Time for a private huddle. I'm gonna put this delicately, kid. You smell like a gym sock's butt.
Thanks.
You smell like a garlic diaper.
Thanks.
You smell like egg salad left in a humidifier.
Thanks.
I assume you don't notice since you live with that stink 24/7.
Oh, no. I smell it.
There's half a speed stick in my desk. It's yours now. Be liberal with it. The coach is on your team here. That's why I pulled you aside to avoid embarrassment.
I guess I wish you would have pulled me aside just a little farther.
I was eating like an animal and suddenly seeing every woman I came across in a new light. Every woman. But worst of all, it affected my favorite activity in the world, the annual school musical.
Welcome, Mr. Goldberg. I have a feeling that this
chorus.
Oh, thank God.
Chorus line, which is a lead.
But I'm in the chorus.
Line.
Oh, thank God.
Which means you have a big solo.
But I'm in the chorus.
Line.
But did you not hear the signs I just speak?
Adam, every boy your age sounds like you. And honestly, I don't have that much to work with here, so I might as well just give the leads to the most enthusiastic kids. Awesome. Okay, let's take it from the top. Sing it with me.
I'm watching Cisco pitter-patter.
Try to stay in the key.
I'm watching Cisco pitter-patter.
You're kind of all over the map. Okay, I'm watching Cisco pitter-patter.
I can do that
too. It's mostly a dance show, and you bring a lot of dance energy. You'll get it.
Okay, could you hear it okay?
Yeah.
Enough to get the gist? Okay. So if you are interested in binge watching a show, that one would be worth your time, especially as future teachers. It is pretty accurate in a lot of ways. So I'm going back to this. Okay. All right. So everything we discussed today really plays into this idea of voice change. But let's begin with anatomy and physiology. All right. So there are two major tubes in your body. The first one goes from your mouth down to your stomach. That is called your
esophagus.
Okay, and then you have a second tube that goes from your sinuses all the way down to your lungs, and that is your trachea. Okay, you need to be posting pictures of these in your room. You need to be posting pictures of anatomy and physiology in your room, in your classrooms. Get a skeleton. Put it in the corner of your room. Your students have great misunderstandings about the body and how it functions. The common response to this question from even college students is, so why do we need to drink a lot right before we perform? Why is that important that we hydrate? Well, so because it keeps our vocal folds moist. No, that would be you were drowning, because they think about it like you don't put water between your vocal folds because that goes into your lungs and that's bad. So that you have, the idea is like you're hydrating your body and so forth. They need to learn about anatomy. You need to know that, like, I have to hydrate my body. I have to know that my larynx is located in the middle of my throat over the top of my trachea like a ring. Put your hand on your neck very gently and say, ah. Where it vibrates, that is where your larynx is located. It's the size of a walnut. It's not big. Do not push on it. Stop pushing on it. Okay. Never manipulate it from the outside of your body. That's bad. But your larynx is about the size of a walnut, and that's the house for your vocal folds. Okay. Our students need to understand where it is, what it is, and how it works. And they need to know things like that you have a stomach and liver and lungs and all of these heart and muscles and things in their bodies. And so when we're talking about hydration before a concert, it's not an hour before. You're starting days before that because your body needs to hydrate your primary organs first. Your larynx is a secondary organ. After the rest of your organs get what they need, then your larynx gets it. So if they're not drinking enough liquid, then they're not going to be hydrating adequately. And so they need to understand how the body works. And you need to understand how the body works. And there are a lot of people that are teaching right now that don't understand how these things work. So it is part of your job to teach that. Here's a top-down version of the larynx, which is like the sheet that you have in front of you. If I were to cut off your head, so if I cut off Griffith's head and I look down his neck, this is what I would see, all right? Now, when your larynx grows, for males, the larynx tends to grow anterior posteriorly, which is front to back. This is all screwed up from our stretched music. Oh, well. It grows like this. And so after puberty, boys have the Adam's apple. So that is because of the growth, the way that the larynx actually grows during puberty in males. And for females, the growth is more rounding or up and down, and so we don't tend to end up with an Adam's apple at the end of puberty. And I will say as a disclaimer, I will wait for that. So anywho, if I cut off Griffith's head and I look down at his neck, this is what I would see. So the vocal folds are the white in the middle. You can see that vocal ligament, it says, but the white right there. And if I keep going down that tube, where am I going to end up? I'm going to end up in his lungs. Yep, so that's the trachea right there, okay? Now, it is really, really important that we show students what this looks like, that we put posters on the walls, that we play video. Has anyone ever been scoped? Do you have a video of your own scope? Show that to your students. Now, the biggest reason that teachers don't like to show this is because it looks like a vagina. And we're just gonna say that out loud, and it's not a vagina. Everyone in this room has one of these, okay? And so we need to get over it, and teach about it, all right? My colleague at the University of Illinois calls this, he's like, Bridget, you're showing your porn again. And I'm like, you have one of these, it's your lyrics, it's not a vagina. And apparently this has become the thing I preach about, because my grad students this summer, after I was teaching a class, had this made for me. It's a plaque, and it says, the lyrics, quote, it's not a vagina. So, I have that in my office. And I think I have never laughed so hard, and I don't think I've ever been so honored in all of my life to get this, because it's true. And the nice thing, they were very thoughtful about it. And like the top part, actually, I can with the round base, it Velcros off, so I can use that if I want to. But I don't know why I wouldn't use it like that. And I said to them, I'm like, what did the engraver say when you took it? And they said, he said, this is not the weirdest thing we've ever engraved. That is amazing. But I love this. I love it. And I think that we just need to get over ourselves a little bit, teach about lyrics, okay? Put posters up, show video. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, I don't have time to show a video today, go on YouTube and Google laryngoscope and find some great videos. They even have videos of people singing like four-part harmony just by scope. It's pretty cool. Students need to see what these body parts look like, because unlike people that play instruments, we don't have buttons to push. We have to do it all by intuition and feel, and this legitimizes what we're doing in the face of our students, in the eyes of the parents, in the administration. If we make this a real instrument, a real thing, and we talk about vocal health, and we talk about ways to take care of it, we will make this much more valid in the eyes of everyone. I'm sure that some of you get this, that are your choral people, they're like, you teach choral, you just sing all day, it must be fun. Yes, that's what we do, we just sing all day. It's just like, y'all come and sing, yes, you know what I'm talking about, yeah. I even get that as a professor. Oh, music, oh, that must be so much, you just sing all day. Yes, I just sit in my office and I sing show tunes all day long. But this is important, we have to be teaching about anatomy and physiology. So not only the parts, but how they function. Anatomy and physiology. And if you are not teaching choir, whatever you're teaching, you need to be teaching about anatomy and physiology, because repetitive stress is a problem, physical health is a problem. I teach a class at Illinois called Healthy Music Practices, and it's how to maintain longevity as a musician, mentally, emotionally, psychologically, physically. And so this is something that we, as a profession, need to be bringing more attention to. And if I had another hour, I would go there, but I don't. So let's move on to this. There are three main things I want you to get out of here. First of all, voice change is most simplistically, it's a gross part of the larynx. Many, many of our students and colleagues think of it as like the glowing orb that is Ariel's voice in The Little Mermaid. That is not the case. It is just a gross part of the larynx. There's nothing magical about it. So we're going to talk about physiological growth. Asynchronization means what? Uneven, not growing at the same rate. So look at the diagrams I gave you. There are so many parts of this. And think about, this is all within the size of a walnut. So if one little piece of this grows on one side, like 2 millimeters more than one on the other side, the alignment is shot. The alignment is just off. And so growth spurt is, voice change is a growth spurt of this organ, and just like physical therapy, it takes time to work through and regain control. That's it, drop mic, walk off stage. Okay? People get freaked out. I don't know how to handle voice change. Well, you just sing through it. It's just like physical therapy for the voice. You just do the best you can. There's patience, perseverance. You have to really work on emotional aspects and psychological aspects so that kids don't just quit because they get frustrated. Another thing that I want you to understand, too, is that everyone grows during puberty, so everyone experiences a voice change. Part of my research I'm doing right now is legitimizing via actual research methodology that female voice change is a thing, and I will talk more about that in a little bit. But girls go through a voice change just like the boys do, and we have to be validating and acknowledging that. That is a really, really big bugaboo of mine right now, and we'll talk more about that in a little bit. The third thing is that voice change is unique for all males and females. Regardless of gender, you have to understand that everyone goes through this in their own way. Some people have a really easy time with it. Some people have a really tricky time with it. And there's no rhyme or reason. There's no predetermining factor. There's nothing. There's no magic code to figure out who's going to have an easier time. boys or girls, both of those groupings. Some are going to be easier, some is just not. Some's going to last for years, some will be pretty quick. But it's unique. So that leads us to the idea of like these classification systems. I'm not anti-classification system, but I have a big problem when people treat them like Bible, because there's no one classification system for voices that fits everybody in your choir. And people do not logically move from phase to phase to step to step. You can use them as guidelines to maybe help voicing, but you need to be really careful that you're not holding them and comparing your students always to those systems that are published. I have the utmost respect for Gackle and Cooksey. However, we just, as a profession, need to be thinking about the student and what they're going through and accommodating music and accommodating things for their needs versus trying to get them to fit a system that's been published about since 1977. Okay. So when the larynx grows, the vocal folds also change, and they extend. Female vocal folds extend 3 to 4 millimeters, which ends up with a range accordingly, but when all is said and done, downwards about a third of an octave, up 3 or 4 pitches. Male vocal folds extend about a centimeter, and then that ends up like a range downwards about an octave and up a sixth. On the paper you have on the side where it says figure 2 at the top, if you look over to the side in the margin, I've drawn what 3 to 4 millimeters and 1 centimeter looks like. So you can see like that's a very, very small amount of growth. It's over on the right-hand side of the page. It's not a lot, but again, when you're talking about an organ that's the size of a walnut, that makes a huge difference. So let's talk for a moment about if we say everybody's a violin when they start, when females go through voice change, it's kind of like stretching the violin to viola and saying, here you go, it's still a treble instrument, it still has qualities that are similar, but it's a different instrument. Do anyone here play a viola? It's not a violin, is it? Absolutely not. It's its own instrument, and it wants to be validated and acknowledged as one. So that's the same thing with female voices. Following puberty, they have a new instrument. It's played much more similarly to where they started than where the males end up, but it's a new instrument. It has to be honored and explored. The male voice change, when males start out with a violin and you stretch it to a string bass, and I hand it back to you, you're going to play it completely different than a violin. Okay, so that's the whole, this is kind of my analogy for you to think about. Like, everybody ends up with a new instrument, but the female instrument ends up closer to where they started than the male instrument, but they're all ending up with something new. And there is a small percentage of people who do not fit, I know I'm being very general, there are exceptions to this rule, there are exceptions to hormonal development, I acknowledge that. We're not going to go down that road because we don't have time today, but I'm talking generally about voice change today. So I'm going to stick with basic classifications of male and female with kind of the typical hormonal development as they move through puberty. Okay, okay, so let's talk about female voice change for a moment. It's largely unacknowledged, largely because it's if you look at anything published, it says that their voices they don't experience the same amount of challenge or difficulty, which isn't fair because, and I'll show you in a moment, that there are things, but because the change from where they started to where they ended is extremely different, again, the violin to viola example versus violin to string bass, it's largely unacknowledged. And I'm not saying that male voice change isn't tricky or hard and it's not complicated for them. I'm not saying that at all, but I'm saying that we need to make sure that we're not ignoring only females. Here's the thing. Who's the majority of the people in our choir? Females. And I'm going to show you in a minute, like the majority of publications are focused on males. And what I found, I just conducted a research study that I'm writing up right now, is I'm finding that females' needs are not being met because all the focus is put on the male singers. And so we can't just say, well, the girls will always be there, we'll always have a lot of them, they're not changing as much. We need to be acknowledging all of the singers in our choirs, individuals, and meeting their individual needs. And so when I talk about this, that's what I'm talking about, is that we can't just say, the numbers of boys are smaller, so we have to focus on them more. We can't ignore the women in our choirs. That is not good educational practice. Singing can be extremely frustrating for females experiencing voice change. They have a raspy or breathy tone. There's lack of phonation of certain pitches, and they lose their vocal color. And there's a large fear of what's going to come out of their mouths, which I'm going to talk more about in a moment. And one of the things is that they are often diagnosed in middle school as an alto or a soprano because they're going through voice change, and then they get stuck on that part forever. That was me. In sixth grade, I went through voice change, and I lost the upper part of my range, and I got put on alto because I played the piano since third grade, and I was a good singer, and I had a good ear, and then I never left. And around eighth or ninth grade, I just assumed my teacher knew what they were talking about, and I couldn't sing high because they always put me on alto and they never gave me the chance to sing high, and so I never sang high. So I am the textbook edition or case of this adolescent alto. Same thing happens on the soprano end of things. I can't sing low, I always sing high. And that is a really big problem. We would not look at a seventh grader and say, you're gonna be a second baseman for the rest of your life. Done, seventh grader. Why?
He hasn't had a chance to explore all the other positions and all the other sports and all the other questions.
That's true. And what else?
He's still growing.
He's still growing. Yeah. Not only that, he's not even done growing yet. You cannot label someone in seventh grade and say, this is what you're going to be a point guard for the rest of your life. And he's like this big. Okay, that's not fair, and we can't do that with our singers either. We don't do it with the men so much, but we do a lot with the women, and a lot of it is because of how they transition through voice change. They tend to lose the upper sorts of color, and they have a higher time singing higher, or vice versa, and so we say, oh, well, you're a soprano, or you're an alto, but they're like 11, 12, 13 years old, and they're not done growing yet. Their voice isn't done having a voice change, and so then they mentally and emotionally get locked into that, and that can lead to some difficulties and ramifications down the road. So we need to, as a profession, be more mindful of this idea and avoid classification. Rather than saying, like, you are an alto, you can say things like, on this song, you're singing alto. That's a world apart from you are an alto. On this song, you're singing soprano. On the next song, you're singing alto. And then on this song, you're singing the bass line up an octave. Okay? Great. Why not? Mix it up. Get SSA piece and have a little bit of everybody sing. I teach this summer choir that we have at Illinois Summer Youth Music. This last summer, and one of the things I'm finding in my research is that students are afraid to advocate for themselves because they look at the teacher. This is middle and high school students. The teacher knows best. I'm not gonna go against what the teacher says. They're right, they know where to put me. But what I got with these middle school students this summer is on two of the songs, I had them pick the part they wanted to sing. So we did an SSA version I got, and the other part broke into five parts. The other song broke into five parts at one part. And I had everybody sing everything. It's a mixed group, eighth graders, 50 of them. Six, seventh, and eighth graders, about 50 of them. I had everybody sing all the parts, and then I let them choose what part they wanted to sing. It was beautiful. It was beautiful. They were like, try different things, and then one of them would come and say, like, can I try that part? Sure, go ahead. When is the last time that you felt like you could ask somebody, can I try that part? Can I sing that part? It never happens. And at this point, if we are worried about people leaving the profession of music because they're feeling physically awkward and we're having to make decisions, this is not the time to be saying, like, no, you have to lock into this part. We have to really give our students a chance to explore all aspects of their voice. And if I've got a soprano part, and I've got a girl who sings really high and a boy who sings really low, and they're an octave apart or so, great, I'm working on ear training. If I have my ladies singing the bass part up an octave, I'm working on reading skills, I'm working on ear. So don't be afraid with this changing voice group to mix it up. You can play with things, you can have fun in the class, you can get them to build their musicianship skills while the vocal stuff is settling. But have them feel good about it. But occasionally give them the chance to pick their part. You'll be surprised at how excited they'll be about that. And they'll, can I try that part? Yeah, okay. It was like I gave them an extra dessert. Yeah, you get down with your bad self, little girl. Great, okay? So, next, the idea that I wanna share with you too is this premenstrual vocal syndrome. I've been really fascinated by this idea, and I've been digging around in it, and it is something that you find a lot in voice science, and you find a lot in performance, but nobody talks about it in music ed. And this is a huge issue that we should be talking about in music ed. So I think that's my next thing I'm going to be doing. What happens is that the human larynx, actually the tissue it's constructed of, is called, and I got this from these boy scientists, quote, hormonal target organ. So the tissue, the cells of the larynx, are much more similar constructed to organs that are sex organs in our body. And so isn't that fascinating? It's fascinating. There's all this research about like pregnant women and how their voices change because of the hormones and everything. And this premenstrual vocal syndrome is part of this, that this is what the scientists say. Concentrations of sex hormones are drastically altered during the premenstrual stage. Estrogen and progesterone levels decrease rapidly, preparing for menstruation. From the dramatic shift in hormone levels, this sudden drop may alter vocal folds through swelling, contributing to vocal fatigue, decrease in range, loss of power, faint hoarseness, loss of range, and loss of agility. In addition, all the patients showed edema, which is swelling of the vocal cords, with thickened mucus and a loss of suppleness, resulting in disturbed muscular and vibratory function. Also issues with stamina, abdominal discomfort that leads to difficulty supporting vocal sound, emotional or mental blocks, and an increase in acid reflux. So these studies were done with adult women. Basically, the closer they got to having their period, they found symptoms in their voice that was changing. The vocal tissue was affected by that. Okay, so we're talking about hormonal adolescents who hormones are not regulated at all. They're like wackadoo crazy. So if we, like, in addition to like the actual length and growth spurt pieces, the tissue itself is experiencing fluctuation and change based on hormone levels. Now, I do not advocate going and being like, now tell me about your menstrual cycle. Like, that would not be what I advocate for. But we can say to our students when we're talking about anatomy and physiology that your vocal folds, not only are you having growth, but like you're all going through puberty. I would have that talk with my students and be like, guess what? You're in puberty. Congratulations. And we would, when I talk about voice change, I'd say, because of puberty, there's hormones to your body, and the hormones are affecting the tissue of your voice. And therefore, you need to know that some days your voice is going to be wacky, and it has to do with hormones. It's not even about physical growth, but it's about hormones. And maybe 2 days later, it'll be better. So therefore, enter vocal health discussion. You need to be kind to your voice. You need to recognize what it feels like when you're straining and pushing. And you need to come talk to me, the teacher, if you feel like your voice isn't in a good capacity. You need to be compassionate, put that humanity out there to your students that they have to start to recognize how they feel about their voices and then be vocal about it if it doesn't feel right. Too many students are just like, I'm gonna suck it up, Buttercup, because I have to, I'm a team player. I don't wanna hurt the choir. I don't want to do anything to hurt the choir. But if they're actually physically feeling something, they need to be honest about it, and they need to react by protecting their instrument. What a lesson to teach middle school students for, like, their life. Especially if they go on to be music major. Did anybody ever tell you about vocal health and things like this when you were that age? Sure didn't tell me. Sure would have helped me out a lot. So think about that, too, in these conversations that you're having with your students. I want to read you this email that I got from one of my colleagues, and she is a singer. She sang at the Met. She's now a professor at Illinois. And a lovely woman, her name's Yvonne Redman. And I asked her about this. I said, so do you talk to your students about premenstrual vocal syndrome? She's like, oh yeah. And she did tell me too that, and some of you may know this, that in European opera houses, well, first of all, they have grace days written into their contract. So when they're menstruating, the women don't have to sing that day. Or in some places, the practice is that they wear a red flower on their dress so that the audience and critics will be kind to them because they're having their vocal tissue may be suffering from hormonal changes at that moment. I was like, who else would go like, what? Would you ever walk on a flower and be like, hey, yep, it's my day? You know, like, I wouldn't do that, but I think that's fascinating. And like, voice performance, that's just the practice. And like, you're an ed, we don't talk about this. And we're working with humans, I find it fascinating. So this is what she says to me in her email. With new students, so she's talking about college students. So again, think too about yourself and then think about middle school students. With new students, I do not approach the subject until a comfortable rapport has been established. This time varies depending on the student's personality, but usually a few weeks into the semester after we've covered selection, repertoire, IPA, and diction. I discuss it casually under the unofficial heading vocal fatigue, recognizing its symptoms and factors that contribute to it. I usually start with lack of sleep, dehydration, vocal use, and acid reflux. I then explain how our monthly cycles can also affect us in the tissues we use to sing, and that this is most often the case during the PMS stage. I also discuss how this stage can also worsen all these symptoms. The best thing we can do is to be aware of a heaviness in our instrument and body and adjust our behaviors to counteract these warnings of fatigue. I then beat into their brains the importance of staying away from anything except Tylenol when they feel swelling in their vocal folds and they experience fatigue in any form longer than a couple of weeks is time for a doctor's visit. So far, this has served me and the students well. One student discovered that she has mini veins close to the surface of her vocal folds, which is common in females, and this is a very important conversation to have with someone like that. With all these students, I find that mentioning the words menstruation and period are very unpleasant and stay away from them completely by using PMS and using the words monthly cycle. So that is someone who I trust implicitly with voice. She's amazing. And that was really fascinating to hear that this conversation is going on, but I've never had anybody talk to me about this as a choral person and a person myself. I would, when you talk about, like, when you put up the larynx and you say, it's made of all this tissue, show these diagrams and say, and tissue is affected by hormones, the boys are going through hormone regulation too, so they're going to be experiencing that as well. So you can encompass a lot of this in just sort of general terms and general discussion. This was what I would do when I would talk about voice change with my students. Literally, this is what I would do. I would say, okay, boys and girls, guess what? You're going through puberty. Isn't that exciting? And they're like, yeah. I was like, you're gonna start smelling bad and all that fun stuff's gonna start happening with your face. But we're also gonna be having voice change, okay? And so I want you to raise your hand if you've ever gone to sing something and nothing has come out. And they raise their hand. Almost everybody in the room raises their hand, if not everybody in the room. Okay, put your hands down. Raise your hand if you ever have gone to sing and you've got like these notes up here and then there's a big hole and then you've got notes down here. Raise your hand if that's ever happened. All the hands go up. And I'm like, look around, notice it's boys and girls. Boys and girls are going through this, you're all going through puberty, you all have voice change. Raise your hand if you've ever gone to sing something and you've had to clear your throat first before you sing. And they all raise their hands. Okay, now let's call this honestly. Some of them have never experienced this, but they're not gonna not raise their hand because their peers are raising their hand. So they're gonna raise their hand just because they don't wanna not be the kid raising their hand. But in that, you gain more community support because they're like, everybody goes through this, look it, it's not weird. But generally, the students have all experienced one of those things, and then I say, so our voices are gonna change, we're gonna have this, is gonna be an issue, somebody's gonna crack, squawk, whatever, you're gonna have issues, come talk to me if you need to, but if something happens, we're not laughing because you're all experiencing it. Got it? Yep, good, done, that's all you had to do. And then I would show every year, every class, I had this video for the University of Michigan Vocal Health Center. It's a laryngoscope. Every year, every class, we would look at the diagrams. I had these on the wall. I would talk about how the voice changes because every year when I have them, they're in a different place of voice change. So they might forget, and then when they come back in, they're like, oh, now this is really relevant to me. And I show the same video, and so this is the video that I have as a person eating pudding at one point. And so they come in and they're like, is this the pudding video? Yes, it is. And the first time ever, I've been showing this video for years, this semester in Choral Methods, two of my big guys passed out from watching the video. I've never had that happen before. I was like, oh my God, falling. Man, this is not a big room. There's 30 kids in these two. And the two like biggest guys were like, couldn't handle the pudding video. But the thing to remember too is that if your students are feeling queasy, it's okay that they don't watch. If you don't like to watch that kind of stuff, it's okay, but it's important to show. But I would give a disclaimer and say, like, if you just want to close your eyes, that's fine. But don't force people to watch this, because some people just might not be in a good space to do that, okay? But if you just put it out generally that everybody's going through this, you could say, and hormonally, that's going to affect it, yeah. I would avoid menstruation. I would avoid those sorts of words, even if I was a woman, unless you're talking one-on-one with somebody, you have a good relationship with them. But you could talk about hormones, because if you talk about puberty, automatically just infers that there's lots of hormones changing. And I would say your hormones are going crazy, which means that your body's changing and blah, 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 blah. Yeah. You can talk about this stuff without getting into sort of discussions that will cross over into sex ed. So if we look at the choral, these are publications on male changing voice versus female changing voice. There are many more on male than female. This chick's pretty awesome. I've heard she's nice. That was so self-serving. Okay, next. But I did. Okay, so I had this article come out in Choral Journal. I did a content analysis of all of the articles since 1977. 1977 was John Cooksey's first publications of his eclectic theory of voice change. That's the one that everybody references when it comes to the stages of male voices. In 1977 was published in the Choral Journal, and since then there have been 31 articles published in the Choral Journal on male voice change. Now Choral Journal is our flagship organization, our ACDAs, that's our big flagship publication. Lynn Gackle published about female voice change, her stages, in 1991. Since 1991, only 5 articles have been published on the female changing voice in that journal. And most of them have been reiterations of her stages. So there's a huge discrepancy in choral music education with regards to attention and put on this topic. And I want to show this to you. So this is a study that I did that was published in the Journal of Research in Music Education last year. And I went to the Durham School of the Arts in North Carolina 3 times over the course of a year, and I tracked a group of students, 14, 2 per grade from 6th to 8th grade to seniors in high school. The teachers helped me identify them. They were showing symptoms of voice change, cracking, and all sorts of phonation problems. And I interviewed them, and they did some journaling for me over the course of that year. And what I found was, the biggest thing is that if you talk to people that work with changing voices, most of them will say, oh yeah, girls have a voice change too. It's all anecdotal. Like, nobody had actually gone through the rigors of research to document and validate it, and so I did that. And so what I found was, really, so there were vocal challenges. So they included a complete lack of phonation in certain areas of vocal range. This is what the women told me, the girls. Excessive breathiness and tone, vocal unpredictability, a lack of strength or endurance when singing, limited vocal range, and difficulties transitioning across registers. Those are identical to the things that were published about male voice change. So they're identifying the same things that boys have identified during voice change. That is really significant. Like, there's evidence now that this isn't happening. The second thing is that the self-identification with the specific voice part was found to be happening really early on, before they were done physically growing. So that, again, reinforces that concern of the adolescent alto or adolescent soprano, that they're already identified, they already identified themselves as an alto or soprano very early on, and that is leading to what they're allowing themselves to do vocally in class, because they're like, I can't do that because I am already a... You got a 7th grader telling me, like, I can't sing high. She's 12. And she's telling me that she's already resigned, that she's never going to sing high. That's problematic. These words, the words frustration, these words embarrassment, these words pride, these were emotions they experienced during their voice change experiences. These are the same words that have been described by males that have been experiencing voice change. So now we have evidence that they are using the same words. And then in addition, they feel very alone during vocal challenges because they feel like no one else is experiencing this. Nobody's talking about this. Nobody's saying that this is normal for them. The boys' voices crack. I'm not supposed to crack. They don't understand that this is normal. So there's a lot of alone. And then when they start to kind of overcome those sorts of problems, there's a really big feeling of empowerment. That's the same. Isolation and empowerment are two experiences that have been documented with male changing voice. And these girls were going through those same two experiences, depending on which ones I talked to and how old they were. So ultimately, the essence of the experience, so I did phenomenological research, and then you end up with kind of this wine reduction, like, what's the nugget of information? And what I found was that the essence of the experience of female voices with a vulnerability and fear of embarrassment determined all of their use of their singing voice. They did like a risk assessment each time they went to open their mouths before they would sing because they were afraid of being embarrassed. And this was at a school for the arts. This was a place where people go to be immersed in the arts, where one would think that these sorts of things wouldn't be an issue, but they were experiencing it in a school for the arts. So if we go to a public school system, it's just, if you think about that, I'm guessing maybe in a system that isn't as supportive for the arts or singing, because this teacher is one of the most supportive teachers I've ever known, it that could be some troubling evidence out there. So this is one of my big takeaways from my article. There should not be a severity threshold that limits or withholds assistance from female adolescent singers, especially with knowledge that they are self-deprecating or feeling humiliated from physiological occurrences out of their control. To disregard such challenges and struggles, we discount the experiences of our changing voice female singers and potentially expose them to the same psychological and emotional risks with which adolescent male singers have struggled. And for me, I think about, like, I have a son and a daughter. I would like to think that when they go through school, that regardless of their gender, that their vocal needs, if they sing in choir, will be met. That they will have a successful experience and they will be allowed to fulfill their full potential. But right now, I feel like that's not happening very well in the choral music education profession. And I have another study that's kind of backing this, that as a profession, we're not doing a very good job with regards to those sorts of things. So, food for thought. Okay, do you have any questions? Yes.
So you were talking about like cautioning and giving a voice part too early. When do you think, eventually, if they decide to do it in college or something, you know, they're gonna kind of want to know, or just like they just kind of select what parts they want?
Well, I think, you know, when they get maybe more into high school, okay, and things start to, the growth starts to kind of settle. However, female voices continue to develop into your 30s. And so, like, to, like, classify yourself, even at that point, I think is, you have to be careful about that. I would just be very open and say, like, your voice is still developed, like, you are 18, you're 16, 17, 18 years old right now. You have, like, if you your voice doesn't finish develop, so the study that I'm writing up right now, I talked to someone, she's 36, and she's like, my voice just got to the point where I feel like I can do what I want to do. I mean, if you think you're talking to a 16-year-old, that's 20 more years that their voice is changing and developing and growing. Now, the voice change is kind of moving past, but the developing of the instrument and all the control and everything like that, there's a lot to happen. So I would just be careful about having them lock in. Because who was telling me that they got to college and they changed from a...
Sam.
Yeah, you were saying, like, I always thought I was a... And then you went to college and they said... Yeah. So, you know, just trying to kind of avoid that, and maybe, like, it would have been interesting to have you sing different parts and see, like, oh, how did the tenor, I would love for you to go back in high school and try to sing tenor and see what that felt like. Would have been fascinating to see. And I'm not saying you can't have kids, like, assign kids to parts, like, you have to have kids on parts, you know, and you can have SATB choirs and all that, but just be careful about saying, like, you know, on this song I want you to sing this part, on this song I want you to sing this part, versus, like, really hardcore hitting home, like, you are a this. I worry about the psychological sorts of lock-in that happens. Mm-hmm.
So when do you start to introduce, like, this is a soprano part, this is an alto part, rather than, like, a part one, two, three?
Whatever you want. Yeah. You can call them whatever you want. I think it's okay for them to know what the parts are. I think in just saying, like, but your voices are changing, so I'm going to be moving you around, or I don't want you to think that you are one over the other. Today, this part might be easier for you, but maybe in 2 weeks it won't be, and that's normal, or whatever the case. But I don't think there's a problem with them knowing the parts. My biggest thing is just saying, like, you're singing the soprano part versus you are a soprano. I did a group of, they had a men's festival in Illinois last year, and it was this huge group of boys, and it was like sixth grade through seniors in high school. Like, it was like this huge span of people, and like, yeah, and they were all coming from these different places, and it was a workshop, and so what we ended up doing was kind of saying, we had lots of people moving around and singing next to people that kind of sound like you, and we ended up dividing them into three groups, and I didn't want to label them yet, because that's the thing too, is like, depending on how old you are, you know, in middle school, if you're singing an SATBP, somebody's singing, you know, like bass baritone, but in real life they're singing, you know, like a tenor line, you know, because they're like really not singing a bass part, like, you know, they're like, I'm a bass, you know, and they're 7th grade, 12 years old, now you're singing the tenor part that's actually called, yeah, so... So I wanted to be careful about labeling them, and so I was like, what do you want to be called? So, like, this group was the Raptors, and this group was the Eagles, and this group was the, I don't care what they want to be called, you know, as long as they don't kind of lock into that, I think this is the only thing I can do. Uh-huh.
So, you have this conversation with your students about puberty,
beautiful. Yes, it has to be woven into the fabric of your class. It can't just be a one and done. Beautiful point. So you reference the diagrams lots. You voice test when, so we had four concerts. I voice tested like four times a year. So I would have them come up and kind of see where they were, and we would talk about that. I have them help me diagnose kind of like, how are we feeling? Which, you know, what notes are comfortable for you kind of a thing. I would say, like, when I'm talking about technique or posture things, I would point and reference diagrams and say, or before concerts, I would say, remember this, or I would just try to pull that in my planning, try to make it a point to pull it in as much as I could. Yeah. That's a good question. Mm-hmm. No, I don't have a problem with sections. What I don't want you to do is only ever sing in that section. I would have you, so like maybe for every concert cycle, for one of the songs, I'd have you sing the soprano line in your range or something. I want you to just kind of get outside the box of thinking about yourself as I can only do this. I only belong in this circle. So, yeah. You know, so I might have students, like, I would keep a running list and say, they sang this, so I would look back. So when I do voice testing, and I would look back and say, like, what did they sing the last time? What did they sing the last two concerts? Like, well, they've always kind of stuck in this part, so I'm going to have them sing this part or whatever. I try to mix it up or, yes, so. Other questions? Okay. I want to listen to a couple of things. So I'm going to play for you. This was a while ago when I taught the middle school singers at my middle school. I have some recordings of them singing, and we want to talk about characteristics in the last little time we have here, and see what you notice about this. The big thing to keep in mind is that middle school students in 6th, 7th, and 8th grade, they are so different from 6th to 7th, 8th grade. So this is the disclaimer. Everything you're going to hear is from the spring, or is from the spring concerts, the last concert of the year. Why would that matter? Had a whole year to work with them, and they're now approaching the next grade. Okay, every year at the end of the 7th grade, I would say to them, I know you're going to turn into 8th graders when you come back. I just want you to know I've really enjoyed our time together, you know, and I'm going to miss you. And then they would come back as 8th graders. So they're very, very different. Those personalities are very different every year. But the voices are now closer to the next level. Everything you hear is vocally healthy and safe. No one is singing anything that's damaging their voice. Okay, I'd like to make that perfectly clear because I was kind of a beast about that. So here's the 6th graders. And I want you to tell me what you hear. Can you hear that a little bit? So what did you notice? Mm-hmm.
It seemed to be a lot of people were singing in like the middle to the low of the range, or a couple who were like a little higher.
Okay, so like if this is your pitch, you had some up here. Partner songs are really good with changing voices, because if you have people whose voices are changing, unison songs are really bad with people that are in the middle of voice change. If you have a group that's all in the same place, unison songs are great. I love unison songs. They work on blend, they learn on tone, they learn on. But when you have people that are changing, you've got like so if you're trying to do a unison song with a poor kid, you know, so partner songs are great because they tend to work both ends of that. What else did you hear? Recording's not as loud as I would like. Mm-hmm. Okay.
I couldn't hear a difference between the male voices and the female voices. It all sounded very sixth grade.
Okay. And if the recording was a little bit crisper, you do this like one voice. Did anybody hear the one voice that was like one kid singing on an octave? Yeah. Generally though, yes. All treble, one kid down. His name was Dan.
Okay, here's another one. So this is seventh grade. There are soloists at the beginning. I set it up, I would never have anybody do anything that I didn't think they could do successfully. So there's a little bit of damage control you have to do after someone sings a solo and it doesn't go so well with this age group. Gotta bulk them up as much as you can so that they don't run away and never come back. Okay, here we go. Oh, and I should say too that I always had the high school band people come and just play stuff and they could play whatever they wanted.
Buckshot, right? Like the pitch was like, here's the note, and they're like all there, they're all around it, right? That's an endearing quality. We're all moving like a mass of bees around, and that's like, and eventually that will work its way out. But that is very common. What else do we notice?
You know, they have less control over it.
Yeah.
Like less dexterity that goes along with like the intonation.
Very much so. And so, we didn't get to because I think I bumped them up, the button, but like the women are also locking more into part to the parts than the males are. Let's see, so this is just to kind of give you an example, this horrible sound situation here. Let me move this along here so you can hear. This is an eighth grader. I'll stop that there. What are you noticing about that? Mm-hmm.
Everything that note settled in more. Are you settling into the parts and they're more sure about the pitch, which makes a little bit more confidence?
Yeah, there's a lot more of actual singing real pitches. And definitely there's more of a presence to the sound and a warmness to the sound because they feel much more comfortable. I agree. What else? And I don't know if you could hear the first solo, she had vibrato at the end, which is starting to kind of emerge, which should be done very on its own. Mm-hmm.
It seems like in seventh grade, the boys were much more vibrato, and they just pushed everything out. And like, it seems
was much more freedom there. Now again, this is the end of eighth grade, so they've been working on this for a year. And this is just a snapshot, so it doesn't mean like every 8th grade group, every 7th grade group, every 6th grade group will be like this, but it gives you the picture of kind of how things can morph and change in a year, how much can happen. Gaining more control over, I didn't talk about this, 2 seconds now I'm talking to you about this. So when the voice actually works, what happens is that your vocal folds zip and unzip like a Ziploc bag. So when we cut off Griffith's head, we're looking down, okay? Zip, pressure builds up, it's a Bernoulli effect, is that the word? Bernoulli effect, thank you. And then they burst through, creating the vibration, and they zip back shut again. That's a very, very simplistic demonstration. Realistically, there's more of a floppy motion like this of the vocal folds, but this idea that they zip and unzip and zip and unzip. So when you're going through voice change, what happens is the muscles in the back part, the posterior part, those are the hardest ones to gain control of, and so that tends to stay open. So if part of it stays open, what comes through? Extra air. And also, if the vocal folds aren't making contact there, what's happening? You're not going to get the sound on those places of the vocal fold. So breaks in the voice, holes in the voice, can't sing that note. They just haven't regained enough control yet to be able to do that. Okay, so kind of at the end of all of this, really our charge when working with middle school adolescents and voice change, and just in general, help ease scrutiny, encourage confidence in themselves to empower them, and really celebrate the good of adolescence and adolescentness. And here's a picture of me when I was 15 years old. Bill Knapp's on my birthday, and that's my grandma sitting next to me. So I really appreciate you having me, and this afternoon if you come, some of these things we're going to do stretch to music with the middle school students this afternoon, so you can come now that you kind of see the process behind the scenes, you can see what it might be like to work with students and how they respond and what you notice about different kids doing that. We're going to work with them in their pieces, you can hear some of the different voice qualities, and if there's time, I'd like the students to talk to you a little bit about like what singing is like for them, and if you have a question that you would like a middle school student to answer, come with that, and so that'll be fun. But it was really a pleasure this morning. Thanks a lot for having me.